Peter, can you tell me how Steiner's ideas and insights have influenced you as a banker,
yeah,
as a person?
Now, first, as a person,
yeah,
it influenced me a lot when I was quite young still. I was very interested in social questions, felt very much connected to Marxism, to anarchism. That was really when I was 14, 15 years old, the books I was reading and tried to understand. You have this big book from Marx, Das Kapital, and very hard to understand, but it was somehow fascinating for me. What does it say about the social question? And then I've been a Waldorf pupil for 7 years, so I, of course, knew Steiner was there in the background, but if you're young, it's not so interesting.
No.
You just go to school. Yeah. But then when I discovered threefold social order as a interesting social principle, how...
Can you explain what you mean by that?
And threefold social order was one of the most interesting ideas of Steiner, that if you look in a more sort of holistic way to society and tries to see what elements are playing a role there, then you see actually three elements playing together through humans. So it's not an abstract system, it's a system and a way of thinking about society what is consequently related to people. It's human oriented, and I like that. And the three spheres Steiner describes is, of course, the economic sphere. People have needs, other people have skills, and how do we bring those together? There's another sphere, the more spiritual, cultural sphere, where each person has a developmental challenge, and everybody should develop in his own way, so freedom is an important principle there, where in the economic sphere, the brotherhood, cooperation is the more important principle. And then, of course, we live together as human beings, so there has to be a government, there has to be a state who treats everybody on an equal base. So there the principle of equality comes in. So these three principles of the French Revolution, brotherhood, equality, freedom, came back in a very organic way. And I was in love with the idea. I thought it solved some of the questions I had with Marxism, where the whole element of freedom was not really developed. But it did also say something about solidarity, about brotherhood. So it was not sort of liberalism per se. It was really the combination what attracted me. So I started to read. I started to read about what Steiner had to say. Not always easy. And then when I went to college to study economics, then I discovered also this initiative Triodos, what was still not a bank then, it was a foundation. And this foundation wanted to do something with money, how to deal more consciously with money. And I was still studying economics, knowing about its threefold social ideas. I thought, well, let's talk to them. And I started as a volunteer at Triodos and started to be very interested in the whole question of money and the impact on people and social life and economic change. And I was then, when the bank was founded in 1980, so a long time ago, I became the youngest co-worker there, one of the first five. So without threefold social order, without anthroposophy, without Steiner, I probably would have a maybe ordinary career in banking, hopefully making lots of money then. But I'm very happy that this other dimension came at such an early stage.
And what are you trying to do then with Triodos and money that's different?
With Triodos, we like to be an instrument for people to deal consciously with money. A lot of people don't know what their money is doing. It's somewhere in the banks, and people start to be more conscious about it, especially after the financial crisis. But before that, people were not very conscious about it. Money was something different, and they had their own life. And what Triodos would like to show, like to be transparent about, is what is money actually doing? Because although you bring it to your bank, it's still your money, and you still have a responsibility, and the bank has a responsibility to help you with what is happening with that money. So that whole idea of transparency, being responsible, seeing the power of money, the power for change, what is in money, but then for the good, not for the bad, is something Triodos Bank is, it's very at the heart of Triodos Bank.
It's what's called ethical investment then, isn't it?
Yeah, we never use the word ethical in that sense, but you could say we bring the question back to the people and say, well, you have to take responsibility, and what your money is doing is something you should think about, and we can help you with that. And because a lot of people feel responsible that their money is doing something good, you could call that an ethical approach to money, and that's what we try to service.
Yeah. And interest rates, I mean, you're much more flexible, aren't you, in that sense? I mean, you don't necessarily appeal to people who want the maximum interest, is that right?
Well, at least what we do is not to go for maximum profit. Interest rate is quite stable and is not so interesting in banking at the moment, but maximizing profit is what banks did a lot. And I'm convinced that banks should look more at what is really needed in society and then make out of that a feasible business. And then you need some profit, of course. You cannot do without profit, but you don't start with profit. Profit is the result. And I think that was also something what relates strongly to what Steiner always said. Profit is not something you aim for. Profit is something what is a sign of a healthy operation. It's emerging from a healthy transaction. And that is a much better way of looking at profit than putting it there as a goal, as an objective, and make everything's work for that goal. That is not what we want to do, and I think that has also created all these issues with financial institutions in the last 2 years. I think what Steiner brought in for the whole question of money, he gave you tools to give it a quality. So the whole terminology he introduced of purchase money, loan money and gift money is quite unique. It's one of those things you will never read or hear in universities. And if you dig deeper in those three qualities of money, you can actually see that it's very important to make that distinction. That purchase money has really to do with the transaction. If I pay something to you, you offer me something. In this moment, I'm valuing what you can do for me. That is the function of money in its quality of purchase money. In loan money, it's very important that you sort of look at the qualities of the entrepreneur, what that entrepreneur can create for values with that money.
And you're, rather than just profit, you mean?
Rather than just profit, but really economic value, because with the money I lend to that entrepreneur, he has to create a business. And by creating the business, he has to service other people, has to make a decent profit, but sufficient that he also can repay me as a bank and also pay interest. So different quality. The whole sort of skills of the entrepreneur are extremely important. And can that entrepreneur really create money and really create values for other people? That's the core. And the gift money is again seen as something what is, and that's an interesting quote of Steiner, I said, that's maybe the most productive money we ever will use. Gift money is much more productive than the other ones, because that's really, there's no strings attached. You can develop the things you need to develop. It's open, it's free, and the most remarkable things can come out who are a benefit for other people. Where with loan money, you still have to see very carefully what skills are there already. With gift money, it's an open space. And we always tend to believe that gift money is a sort of extra money. If you don't know what to do anymore, you have gifts. But to put it all the other way and say gift money is actually the most productive money you can have, but it does require a lot of attention, a lot of consciousness, a lot of awareness to whom you give it, but then it's free and that person should work with it. Those three qualities of money, I think, are extremely interesting new sort of thinking in economics. Yeah. and brought something to us, but I think also more in general in society. I hear more and more people speaking about this is purchase money, this is gift money, and they don't know where it is coming from. And I think it's interesting. Yeah. It's happening there. Yeah, yeah. That's the way it should be.
Yeah, yeah. The film we're making, I'm calling The Challenge of Rudolf Steiner. I mean, what would you understand by this word challenge?
Well, I think the challenge of Rudolf Steiner for me was that, as I see it, is that he had his wonderful insights, his deep insights, but how are we working with those insights? And how are we not just repeat what he said, but how do we start to understand them, maybe transform them, and make them to a part of our own life? So it's true, and it's not just a repetition of what he said. And the challenge is that we stay away from the repetition, from the copying, and feel very much that what he had to bring is a catalyst for us, for ourselves, to think about more consciously about what we are doing, and to bring in always the human element in that. Because that is what I feel strongly with Steiner. He always had the human being in the back of his mind when he was talking about economics, about medicine or whatever. And that is an important element what we can learn about, because most of the thinking now, we exclude the human being. It's about the system, and the human being should fit into the system. And what he did is was saying, well, let's take each human being as a starting point, and let's design something around that, what can work to serve human beings. And that deeper principle, I think, is quite important. And you cannot achieve that by just copying what he has said or just repeat what he has said. I think that's the challenge, maybe not so much for him, but for us to work with what he has brought to us.
Because I was going to ask you, but in a sense you answered it. I mean, if you had to sort of sum up the essence of what Steiner tried to bring into the world?
Well, I would say the essence is that it is deeply human. Yeah, what he brought a lot of ideas, and we not always understand the ideas, and maybe some of them are even wrong. I mean, he was a human being after all. But what I always felt as a very strong sort of gesture behind it, it is about the development of mankind, of human being, and with an humility to that, then you can start to work on ideas. But if you don't have that gesture behind it, it becomes abstract. And even with some anthroposophical ideas, they can be quite inhuman if you have not that gesture behind it. So that, I think, is fundamental to me, what it brought me at least, and what I learned from how to work with that gesture behind it.
I mean, some people, you know, in a way, understandably, when they come across Steiner, they think, well, how on earth could somebody know things in that sort of depth, that kind of precision? Yeah. And that can be quite off-putting even for people. I mean, I don't know what you feel about that.
Well, I'm quite lucky because he didn't say so much about economics. That was not his sort of first area. There was more education, medicine, the arts. And in the economic world, he tried a few things. The Comme de Taque was an important economic invention. Didn't work very well.
A journal?
No, that was with this whole group of enterprises he worked together with the Waldorf Astoria. Mm-hmm. And they wanted to make an association together. But it was in the middle of the financial crisis, also of the...
After the First World War,
After the First World War, so it all broke down, and it had to be rescued what was there, and things really had to be rescued. So it was not a good experience, actually. And there is not so much about economic science as such. There is one very good book, World Economy, National Economische Koers, where the basic principles of economics are laid down, and it's still an extremely valuable book, but there is not so much written by him as in the other areas, and I think that's great, actually.
You're free.
You're more free, and you're not sort of... There is one book you can read, and it's done in a very sort of pleasant way. Yeah. It's very close, actually, what you learn also in university, in the way he brings it. It's really for students. Yeah. But at the same time, it's totally different, bring new concepts in it. And you can always refer to that book, and that's fantastic. But you have to do a lot of thinking yourself. That is quite clear. It's not so much what he gives as guidelines you can follow.
But I think he wanted people to do a lot of thinking anyway, in whatever space.
Yeah, yeah. And sometimes you feel maybe there was so much that that prevented people almost to do that. And in the economic finance sphere, there was not so much. So that trap was not so big for us, for our sort of profession as bankers. What I find interesting in the last sort of 5-6 years, so just before the financial crisis and after the financial crisis, that what we transformed in a way as Triodos Bank. We were a little niche bank. People said, it's great, such a bank is there, nothing wrong with it. We were growing, flourishing. But suddenly through the financial crisis, there was a much deeper question to us about the bank itself, not just about the projects we finance, but what is banking about? And that was for us really a wake-up call. How do we see ourselves? And that made it very important again to go back to the roots of the bank. What do we want to achieve with the bank? What is what we want to do? And going back to the roots means it has been created out of the anthroposophical movement, but it has never been kept in the anthroposophical movement. It has been a gift to the world, but a real gift, not with strings attached. So we really could be a bank, but with a strong value base. And the value base is that we look at the human being as a starting point and include spiritual dimensions in our judgment, include social dimensions and the finance dimensions. And that was really a new element we had almost to rediscover again to make clear what this banking is about. So that was new, and therefore we suddenly they're out in the open, and people still ask where is this coming from, and sometimes know about the anthroposophical roots of the bank. And it's very interesting, today you can speak very openly about it, as long as you not try to sort of explain where it is all coming from in detail, but as a sincere new approach to banking, where anthroposophy had played a role in the preparation, so to speak, but not as a model what has been described long time ago and now is implemented. That doesn't work. And people are quite open to that new approach. So we are in a total new situation. And I feel that is maybe the role of anthroposophy today, not so much to be in a silo, in an identified movement, but really be out there in the world and mix with everything what's there already and try to co-create with others instead of preach or teach. So we have to move from that phase, from telling others what we think is the truth, to a movement where we co-create with others, accept that we don't have all the knowledge, the wisdom ourselves. Others have developed a lot of interesting things as well. And then suddenly there is a huge space for anthroposophy to work through people in the world. And my really hope is that that will continue now, that if we will hit more crises, that this element of anthroposophy through people, but in a free, co-creative way, will be the new sort of approach. Instead of, come to us, we tell you what is the truth, and therefore you just do what we tell you to do. That doesn't work.
What Steiner said.
Yeah, that's even worse. But I think we have to sort of practice it ourselves, be co-creative, and share it with the world. And be there with the world, not stay away from it.
You used the phrase spiritual element. I mean, what do you mean by that? What do you understand by that? I mean, people understand social.
Yeah, spiritual, I mean, there is also a world, an invisible world, a world where we don't know exactly how it works, and where people, if they sort of school themselves or are happy, or opening up for that dimension, that invisible dimension, can learn from it, not as a separate world, but as a world what works into the day-to-day work, and that there is a relation between the two. So what we want to do is not to say, well, there is a spiritual world and there's a world here. What you actually want to do is to say, well, this spiritual world works in our day-to-day work, and what we do has also consequences on other people and on what we would call the invisible world. And that element is something what you have to carry with you in your day-to-day work. Otherwise, you're quite sort of isolated from the broader perspective. And my experience, the more you talk about it, the less people understand. The more you sort of do it, live it, the more people sense there is something very true there. So it's a very interesting element of, if you talk about spirituality, you actually have to live spirituality, in my view. You have to do it, and people will communicate on another level. We see it in the bank as well. If we talk a lot about the mission, we make it more and more intellectual, we get more and more differentiated, all sort of views and thinking. And if you bring it more on a heart level, then suddenly people connect. Then they feel, of course, there is another aspect to life as well. Well, it's not always something you can put in material, in concrete things, but it is there, it is a reality. So I would say there is another challenge for us to bring the intellectual spirituality to a more heart spirituality, bring it on this level. And that is not always a matter of talking a lot about it, that is doing together, being together. So that makes it also so hard to speak about it, because you have to do it. So that's what I would say the challenge of spirituality and anthroposophy within that context. The question is, how do you bring this more holistic approach across to the ordinary man and woman in the street? That is a challenge of a bank like we, with almost 300,000 customers. Many people want to join us. How do you bring that across? And a very interesting way we have discovered now, and it was actually not us who invented it, was our new sort of strap line. And what we say in the Netherlands now, and I can translate it in English, is we say, follow your heart, use your head, Triodos Bank.
Say it again?
Follow your heart, use your head, Triodos Bank. And when I saw that, when they presented it to me, so that was an external, non-anthroposophical bureau, I thought, they got it. They're exactly what it is about. It's follow your heart, that's on this level, think it through, use your head, nothing wrong with using your head, and then bring it into the will, do it. And that's what we are about. We offer you that possibility. So that's for me a way of bringing anthroposophy, because this threefoldness is in that sort of strap line, how you bring that into practice. And immediately see when we used it, people started to say, that's exactly what Triodos is about. Follow your heart, use your head, Triodos Bank. And I feel that's a good example of how we have to learn to communicate in a more simple, direct way about those qualities. And then people will get it. If we start to do it too much in models and thinking, people will never be related to what we are doing. So this is an element it's nice to share with you.
But that could apply to really many, many areas of life. You could say all areas of life. Really.
Absolutely. Yeah. But we are a bank. At the end, we say Triodos Bank.
Yeah.
So we relate to what we do. But that's true. That's true.
Or a teacher or a farmer.
Absolutely. Yeah. So we're happy if they share it with us. No problem. But so simple. So we had all sort of complicated intellectual lines, creating added value and all sort of, know what your money does or other things. And we all felt, it's true, but it's not what's about. And this one is for the first time, I feel, we have it right. Good. So that's the fascinating thing of being an entrepreneur, being in business, and having to communicate with the larger world. You cannot close yourself off and say, well, we know as anthroposophists where we can talk about. We can't. That doesn't make sense. We have to find the right sort of synthesis.
Are you comfortable with this label, anthroposophist? I mean, are you, or anthroposophy? Do you think that's a handicap in some ways? Does that create a barrier in people's minds, or do you think it's...
Well, it depends very much on yourself, how you use it. If you use it as a defense, as an argument, then it doesn't work. if it's an open question from people, what is the sort of, where are your ideas coming from? You all made it up yourself, or is there a relation with something more? You can openly speak about it. And then it's appreciated, but it's only appreciated when it's connected to your day-to-day work and what you are yourself. So it's very much about presencing, about being yourself with anthroposophy, and then there's no problem. And sometimes you make mistakes there, then you use Steiner too easily with something, or if you use, you don't even mention him, but you use a sort of thought or from somebody else as well. If you have not worked it through yourself, people today are much more conscious about it. Where maybe 20, 30 years ago, people appreciated that you had all this knowledge from books. Now they only appreciate what you do in the moment yourself, what you are. And that is a good development, I think. It's not an easy development, it's a good development. And that's also very healthy for anthroposophists, to be in the moment, represent what you are, how limited that maybe is in your own view, be what you are, and then people will have no problem if you make that clear that anthroposophy played a role in that, or even can refer to that, no problem. So I think it's not an issue. It's an issue, anthroposophy becomes an issue if you have not really digested it yourself. And there are always parts you have not digested yet, and then it becomes an issue. So I don't think it's a real issue.
And what you're describing, I think that pattern exists in all sorts of isms, in a sense. It's not just unique to
this
principle of making something one's own is absolutely fundamental to human development.
And that helps also the anthroposophical movement sometimes to come down from the tower they're in and say, well, there are other movements who deal with exactly the same problems. You have fundamentalists, you have people who just read books and tell fantastic stories. You have people who do things and maybe not so good in expressing the ideas behind it. It's all part of this fantastic diversity. And that's where you have to deal with as a movement. We are not exclusive in that sense. And that helps as well to make it more part of the bigger society.